interest in relation to any item on the agenda? No? Okay. Are there any matters of urgency to admit onto the agenda? No? Okay. In that case, then, we move on to the minutes of the previous meeting. Anyone had a look at them? Anyone had any comments to make on the minutes? Can we take those accurate record? Is that agreed? Okay. Okay. Item three, the external audit plan. We're going to consider the reports from the authorities' external auditors. So, Gillian Rose, your grand daughter, you can take the floor.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Chair. So, we presented the audit plan to finance team back in April, and this was agreed, and obviously it's come to this committee because this was the next one in calendars. This document essentially summarises the work that we undertake to provide our opinion on the financial statements and to provide the authority with a vote on the conclusion for the year ending 31st of March 2019. In terms of the key risks identified within the document, which starts on page 4, these are the considerations of issues that would impact on our audit approach. These essentially are issues that most fire authorities are facing. There's nothing specific to Merseyside Fire Authority. It just gives you a flavour for the issues that we consider as a whole across all of our audits at Grant Thornton. Turning to page 5, these are significant risks identified. Again, these aren't any different to those that we would flag in our other clients. The only specific issue for yourselves is the accounting for PFI, and that's really to ensure that the entries into financial statements are appropriate and accurate. The document then goes on to talk about materiality, and this just gives you a flavour for the levels to which we audit the financial statements. So essentially anything above £1.5 million, if we find an error or adjustment, we would expect the authority to adjust the accounts by that. Anything below that, we report to the audit committee as those charged with governance. That just really just gives you a flavour for the values we will be auditing to. On page 10, this then talks about the value for money arrangements. There, we've only really flagged financial sustainability. That's in line with many of our other clients and indeed most of our local authority clients. That just is a reflection of the austerity and the financial position of most of our public sector clients. Nothing specific as a risk for the authority itself, but it's just our consideration of arrangements that are in place to ensure that the authority has got the appropriate arrangements to secure value for money. The next slide is, or the next page is on the team and fee, and then a declaration of our independence. We have to do that within every document that we provide to you. Happy to take any questions if there are any.
Do any members of the committee have any questions? Thank you. I was just wondering actually, looking at these significant risks, I was wondering if the impact of leaving the European Union is something which the external auditors have considered.
We do flag that, I think. We had flagged it in our initial draft, but given the decision to delay, I think we removed that. But it is something that is on the agenda. Ian receives regular updates from Pulse Radio and the engagement lead. We do have what's called a Brexit room, and that has considered the impact on the public sector. And I know many organisations have joined that. And obviously the debate rumbles on, but yes, it is something we've certainly considered, and there were issues flagged with us right at the start of the financial year in terms of implications for particular areas of the financial statements. But I think, as we all know, it's pretty much status quo, but obviously things will develop as months go on.
Okay, so if there are any further questions, are people happy to accept that report?
Happy, agree.
Okay. Item 4, Treasury Management Annual Report. This evening.
Happy Chair, thank you. Members approved the Treasury Management Strategy as part of the 2018-19 Budget Report. Members have received regular updates on the actual Treasury Management performance against the strategy as part of the Quarterly Financial Review Report and the Interim Treasury Management Report. And as per paragraph 8 on page 26, this report outlines the Treasury Management performance for 2018-19, and it demonstrates that Treasury Management's activity has been carried out in line with the approved strategy and within borrowing and Treasury Management limits set by the authority. Paragraphs 14 to 21 on pages 27 to 29 summarised Treasury Management activity in the year, and a more detailed report is attached as Appendix A to the report. However, in summary, no new borrowing was arranged in the year. Outstanding debt fell by £500,000 to £37.6 million. Investments fell from £31.4 million to £22.1 million. And Treasury Management practices have maintained full compliance with the approved strategy and relevant codes and statutes. Members are asked to note the report, but I'm happy to take any questions on it.
Do any members have any questions on the Treasury report? No. Can I ask what the current reserves ratio is with regard to the revenue budget? Do you know that figure?
Try and work out quickly. The budget's roughly around £60 million, and you're going to get an outturn report on 2018-19 general fund and reserves position. The reserves have fallen by about 10% from, I think, to around the £24 million to around £21 million. So it's about a third. If you take it just over £20 million, it's about a third, 30-something percent. However, it's worth noting that back in 2016-17, earmarked reserves were nearly £30 million. So we're on a downward trend, as we predicted, and in 2019-20, we're probably subject to the major capital bills around St. Helens and the TDA. We could potentially use another £10 million plus. So by the end of 19-20, we could be closer to £10 million. Helps, Chair.
No, that's helpful, thank you. So it's safe to say that the reserves are dwindling, and a significant portion of those reserves are very much earmarked for the project. Okay, are we happy to accept that report?
Yeah.
Okay, item 5, the annual year-end internal audit report.
Thanks, Chair. This report summarises the work carried out by internal audit during 2018-19. Paragraph 4 on page 38 outlines, based on the reviews carried out by internal audit during 2018-19, that internal audit's view on the performance of the system of internal control in place at MFRA in the year was that substantial assurance that could be placed on the system of internal control in place and it caused with proper practice, and a substantial level of compliance with internal control systems and processes was found, and that no weaknesses have been identified that may present a material corporate risk to the authority. The table after paragraph 5 on page 38 summarises the audit reviews carried out in the year. The top half of the table on page 5 relates to fundamental finance systems audit reviews, of which 5 have been completed, 1 is at the draft report stage, and 2 are currently being reviewed by internal audit, and 1 is still at the fieldwork stage. However, all completed audits have shown a substantive control environment and compliance assessment. The other audit work relates to areas that the MFRS officers have asked internal audit to review. 3 have been completed. 1 completed audit is still with the relevant MFRS officer to consider. 2 are currently being reviewed by internal audit, and 1 is at the fieldwork stage, and 2 have been deferred until 2019-20. All completed audits, though, have shown substantive or acceptable control environment and compliance assessment. No audit reviews have identified any potential significant corporate impact risk for the authority. Appendix A on pages 45 to 48 provides members with a brief background to each audit undertaken in the year. Members are asked to note the report, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Do any members have any questions? Thank you, Chair. Well, basically, just comments. As I see it, this is an excellent report, and it's all very positive, which I welcome. My specific question, Chair, is on page 39, where it says the cost of the internal audit service was £35,500. Is that more or less what we budgeted for? I've got no idea in my head whether that's a reasonable figure. Was that the type of figure that we were expecting anyway?
Yes, that's the figure we budgeted for. We had an agreed service level agreement with the group. So we agreed to pay that amount for 112 audit days a year. If at any point in time we needed to have additional days, if there was a significant risk or issue identified, we can negotiate for additional audit days at an additional cost.
Okay. Thank you, Chair.
Any more questions? Just a quick one from me then on page 49 about the actual versus budget to date. I was just wondering if there's any particular reason for the upturn in strategic and ad hoc reviews. Is there a specific project that's happened, something like that?
There will be a reason for it, Chair. I'm just going to try and go to... There's no detailed breakdown, unfortunately. I can find out for you, but there would be a specific reason. It probably is. You've seen our audit plans that a piece of work has taken longer than we thought, or that we asked for additional work to be done as part of that. I can get a full breakdown if you want to the difference between the plan and the actual.
I notice in net terms, it's...
Sometimes, Chair, what it is as well, that the previous year's audits, like we said in this report, two of the audits planned for this year have slipped into 2019-20. And so sometimes what you get is that top and tailing of audits planned for one year slipping into another year. I suspect it's the completion of 17-18 audits in 18-19 utilising some of that contingency.
Any other questions on that report?
The authority is required to prepare an annual statement reviewing the authority's governance and systems of internal control arrangements that were in operation during the year. The annual governance statement attached as Appendix A to the report meets the requirement to review and consider the effectiveness of the governance framework, including the system of internal control that the authority has had in place during 2018-19. Point 3 on page 58, 2.4.62 on page 65 outlines the key elements of the systems and processes and their effectiveness that underpin the authority's governance and internal control arrangements in the year. And on point 4.7 onwards, it outlines some of the potential challenges that the authority may face in the future. Members are asked to approve the annual governance statement and that the chair sign the statement on behalf of the authority. Looking forward now, we've had all the reports looking backwards. This is a report now that looks at 2019-20's proposed internal audit plan. As I said, the authority buys in 112 audit days a year as part of the SLA with Liverpool City Council's internal audit service. The report outlines the proposed allocation of the audit days over various projects in 2019-20 Appendix A attached to the report outlines the allocation of the 112 days in detail. But in summary, as the plan must include a review of the fundamental financial systems in order to provide assurance to the authority, treasurer and external auditor that the systems have met the required financial administration standards, including the relevant internal control processes during the year, 40 audit days have been allocated for this work. Senior leadership team then considered what strategic review should be put forward for 1920 and have allocated 42 days to cover the 7 strategic reviews outlined in the appendix, and then the balance of the audit days is taken up by ad hoc investigations, unplanned audits and audit management work. Members are asked to consider the proposals in Appendix A and approve the 2019-20 plan. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
Thank you, Chair. Some quick questions. Curious on Appendix A, the first item. Why 4 days are needed to review the payment process for debit cards in canteen? It seems a fairly simple process that doesn't use any cash. So.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we haven't had a system that's been able to take debit credit card payments before. So we're using this as a trial run to see if it could be extended to other areas where we take payments off the public. So why we've allocated 4 days is we want more of a comprehensive, not just it's to see how the cash, how the transaction flows through on the bank statements, who does what reconciliations, and what will be in place, and to make sure all the references in the system are easily identifiable and the relevant even goes to the relevant codes. So we're probably doing a warts and all sort of review of the process, because it's about looking, can we extend it anywhere else and what lessons we can learn.
Any other questions? I noticed on Appendix A, firefighter safety is on there, but it doesn't seem to have any data assigned to it.
That was my deliberate error by not deleting the text from the statement, because we obviously had a number of issues and I haven't taken that text off or some of the draft proposals. But that, I'm going to say, is my deliberate mistake. Uh-huh. And well done for spotting.
Go back, there might be a few more.
A few minutes here. To be honest, there is.